Dividing up land, and when they got to the end, and how they The Lord spoke to them and he says, okay, now you need to get a city of refuge. So we have a refuge. Okay. I meditate on that. And he had me open up to Psalm 91. I said, okay, let me meditate on that. And then I decided I was going to print everyone Psalm 91 in the King James translation. And the flip side of that, I emailed myself. So, you know, you can, it's forced into a two-page double-sided. And I flip side, I said, well, I'll have the NIV on the other side. Finished, and I said, oh, let me lay it aside until I get ready to minister that word. Not thinking that I was going to minister that word this morning. Amen. But the Lord said, it's well. When I was in my office, he said, it's well. You know, I like to spoil people. When you know I like to type things and print it out and pass it out. And as I say that, before I go into the word, how many have been blessed by the two decrees? Open 2017 with. Amen? There are more. There are 15 more, but I just want you all to meditate on them. Amen? And can I just, before I go into this, just clear you of, we won't be doing the Daniel fast this month. Spirit of the Lord ministered to me. He said, out of habit, you normally do the Daniel fast in January. But because you have just a few days short of 6 months of apostle transitioning, number one, I am directed not to fast at the present time. And I said, okay, do something else. But for those of you who have purpose to fast, if you desire to fast, do it just 10 days. If you just do it just 10 days, that's scriptural. Because Daniel fasted from vegetables and water. And I'm going to release this before I go into the word, because I know people are just leaping for joy that they can continue. Every year when we get ready for Daniel fast, we start detoxing days before with our lemon water and just making sure that our system is free of all those toxins. So I know everybody is happy. Y'all didn't shout me down. You know, I said, okay, Lord, when he was ministering to me last night, I said, I'm going to write all these things down. So when I get up before Pastor Malloy ministers, I'll just release this. And the Lord said, you won't hear a sound. I said, oh, okay. I didn't hear a sound. Y'all are just wondering. I heard someone say, okay. You know, they were just kind of trying to figure it out. But the Lord is gracious. And because our founder transitioned not even 6 months ago, it's not time for us to go into the Daniel fast as we would. Okay? It's not time for us. We will get time. It may be before the end of this year, but it's not time yet. Amen? I know I got some real big smiles up there. Smiling like I can hold my coffee. Amen?
Oh my God.
Some people really love coffee. I do have to warn my brother in Arizona, because he said, I'd like to fast with the church. I said, do you drink coffee? He said, every other day. I said, yeah, but you drink Starbucks.
Oh, good Lord.
So you got to really detox. So I just please remind me to hit him up and tell him we're not going to do the fast. I should have, you know. We do have to understand, God does all things well. He knows when our timing. So for those of you who are determined to do some type of modification to your diet, amen, but we're not going to do the 21-day Daniel fast. We'll just bring it to, if you do, bring it to 10 days if you want to. Amen? Nevertheless, we are going to be focusing in on some prayers for the month of January. Amen?
Amen.
Now let's go into the word of the Lord. The word is entitled Finding Strength and Comfort in the Secret Place of the Most High.
There you go.
In the secret place of the Most High. Today we need comfort. There are all things, all kinds of things that are going on in this world, but let's go into what the psalmist has written in verse 1, he says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eye shalt thou see and behold the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against the stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder, the young lion and dragon shalt thou trample under feet, because he has set his love upon me. Therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. As I read that, the Spirit of the Lord brought back to my remembrance that the reason why he instructed me to type that, to do the Psalm 91, is because he wants us to read that every day. So if you have it on your phones and you have it in your Bibles, remember to read Psalm 91, whether it's NIV, the Amplified, the Message, whatever translation, remember to read that. Thank you, Lord, for bringing that back to my remembrance. That's why I had purpose to hand it out, so that you would have it. But everybody is into saving trees now. We're into saving trees, and we'd like to use our little techie devices. I don't have a problem with that, y'all. Saving me some reams of paper. So, can y'all do that?
Yes.
Can you read it and meditate it and declare it every day over your life, every day?
Yes.
Amen? That's what we're going to do for the month of January. Over and over and over and over again. Apostle and I committed that to memory. We would declare that. We would declare that he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Commit it to memory. Amen. It will rise up for you just when you need it.
Amen.
Our sinful world is full of danger, diseases, injuries, and disasters. Our risk of everyday life, we never know when we might contract a serious illness, be involved in an accident, or find ourselves in the midst of a disaster. Over and above these perils, the greatest threat in our world is the evil perpetrated by the wicked people, who pose a very threat, very real threat to all who truly follow Christ. Scripture warns us that as we grow nearer to the return of Christ, the wickedness of people will increase, and we will find ourselves living in perilous times, according to 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 5. And we know that we're living in perilous times, where you have seen and heard, no doubt, of the different murders and just senseless crimes where people just break out and shoot innocent people. The dangers of life and its ongoing threats can leave us feeling insecure. In spite of our best efforts to protect ourselves, we know that we can not totally shield ourselves from harm. For generations, God's people have turned to Psalm 91 for comfort and courage. It reminds us that God is our security. Psalm 91 appears to promise that those who live close to God will be exempt from harm, disaster, and disease. And this impression presents a problem. Many people who faithfully abide in Christ do experience harm.
Amen.
They do encounter and sometimes perish in disasters. They do contract serious illnesses or diseases. What about the persecuted? What about the martyrs? The experience of God's people does not agree with the supposed promises of this psalm. The answer to this dilemma is found incorrectly understanding to whom these promises were made. Psalm 91 celebrates the specific promises of God's covenant people with Israel. Two specific perils are prominent in this psalm: the peril of enemy attack and the peril of pestilence or plague. And what I want you to do is turn quickly with me to Deuteronomy, the 7th chapter, verse 12 through 24. I might not read all of them, but I just want to start out and just let you see something. It says there, "Wherefore it shall come to pass, if ye hearken to these judgments and keep them, and do them, that the Lord thy God shall keep unto thee the covenant and the mercy which he sware unto thy fathers." If you found it, say amen.
Amen.
"And he will love thee, and bless thee, and multiply thee. He will also bless the fruit of thy womb, and the fruit of thy land, thy corn, and thy wine, and thine oil, the increase of thine kind, and the flocks of thy sheep, in the land which he sware unto thy fathers to give thee. Thou shalt be blessed above all people. There shall not be male or female barren among you, or among your cattle." And what does it say? "And the Lord will take away from thee all sickness, and will put none of these diseases of Egypt, which thou knowest, upon thee, but will lay them upon all them that hate thee. And thou shalt consume all the people which the Lord thy God shall deliver thee. Thine eyes shall have no pity upon them, neither shalt thou serve their gods, neither shalt thou serve
their gods.
Neither shalt thou
serve."
Notice that. Keep that in memory. "For that will be a snare unto thee." One of the things that I referenced on last week from Daniel, and Daniel wrote that he wrote about the wicked and how the wicked serve idol gods. But it said the people that know their God shall be strong and do great exploits. It kind of ties in there some way. It relates in the sense that when you serve the true and living God, he will keep you protected. But when you serve idol gods, when you serve false gods, he says, "Neither shalt thou serve their gods, for that will be a snare unto thee. If thou shalt say in thine heart, these nations are more than I, how can I dispossess them? Thou shalt not be afraid of them, but shalt well remember what the Lord thy God did unto Pharaoh and unto all Egypt." Let's pause there. I want to scroll down here to another verse. It says, "And the Lord thy God will put out those nations before thee by little and little. Thou mayest not consume them at once, lest the beasts of the field increase upon thee. But the Lord thy God shall deliver them unto thee, and shall destroy them with a mighty destruction until they be destroyed. And he shall deliver their kings into thine hands, and thou shalt destroy their name from under heaven. There shall no man be able to do what?
Stand
until thou hast
destroyed them."
The connection between this passage of scripture and Psalm 91 is clear. These promises were made to Israel as a part of the old covenant, and they were conditional. Someone say conditional.
Conditional.
They were conditional on Israel's faithfulness to God. They needed to be faithful to who?
God.
They are about these promises. These things are about God's disciplinary judgment on those who are unfaithful to him. As long as Israel remained faithful to God, made him their dwelling or refuge, he would protect them from their enemies and from deadly diseases. If they turned from God and broke his covenant, he would lift his hand of protection. Throughout Israel's history, that proved to be true. You can read the book of Judges and see how God lifted his hands of protection. He would release a judge among them. They would get back on the right path, but then they would backslide, and they would go away from God. There's a passage of scripture that comes to my mind in Matthew 6:33. It says, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." You can see there in that first part of that scripture where God commands, or the Lord Jesus, and this is a New Testament scripture, where we are instructed to seek first whose? The kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God is God's way of doing things. The principles, God's way of doing things. And when you do things according to God's will, God's plan, God is obligated to take care of you. But when you step out in disobedience, he's not obligated to take care of you. Let me go further. These promises were really not made to the church, some say. Here in Psalm 91. Even though we declare them and we believe every word of God is true, we can apply, I beg the differ, and I say that we can apply them twofold. Even though in scripture Jesus promises followers exactly the he promised that we would face harm. He promised us, he told us, and I won't say he promised us, but he released that information to us through the word that we would face harm. We would be persecuted. But he would be with us. So I'd like to declare that Psalm 91 is for us as well as, and initially it was for the children of Israel, but we can grab a hold of those promises and apply them to our lives. But I'm just giving you the understanding, the history of this passage of scripture. We know that, for example, Paul spoke openly about the perils that he had suffered in 2 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, verse 25 through 27. For those of you who don't know, Paul was one who wrote a great portion of the New Testament. And you would think, wow, he wrote a greater portion of the New Testament. He really shouldn't suffer a whole lot. Notice this one thing that the Word of God says, if you suffer with me, you will reign. And there in this passage of scripture in 2 Corinthians, it says, Paul says, "Thrice was I beaten with rods, once was I stoned, thrice I suffered shipwreck, a night and a day I have been in the deep, in journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, and fastings often, in cold and nakedness." Now the first one, people would have said, "I would give up." Beaten with rods, I give up. That's it, I give up. Stoned three times, I give up. You would, to deal with all of the sufferings that Paul went through, you would say, wow.
Yeah.
You know, I thought because you're a believer, you're not going to go through any sufferings. But we do go through sufferings.
Yes, yes.
There are principles outlined here in Psalm 91. And I want to say several things, lay these things before you. God is to us today everything he has always been to his people. God is our refuge.
Yes. Yes.
We need not live in fear of danger or threat, for God is always with us.
Yes.
If we faithfully abide in Christ, we need not fear God's discipline or judgment. That's conditional. We have to abide in Christ faithfully. God's angels continue to guard his children. God is our security in these perilous times. But these are last days. Scripture says that the new covenant is established on better promises than the old. Whereas Israel was promised God's conditional protection, we are promised God's unconditional presence. We are promised whose unconditional presence?
God.
Under the old covenant, the people had to dwell in God. under the new covenant, God dwells in us. The first thing I want to point out is in Psalm 91, 1 and 2. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord that he is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. One of the things I need to stress is that we need to draw near to God. We need to live in God's presence. There was a writer who really, he wrote this after, but he practiced the presence of God. You can be in the presence of a great number of people. You can be at work. You can be doing many things and practice the presence of God and stay engaged with what you need to do. But practicing the presence of God, meditating on his word, holding fast to what he has said. Amen? Amen. Allowing God to get a strong grip on you. Yes. Are you with me? Yes. The promises of this psalm apply exclusively to those who draw near to God and live in his holy presence. This is a secret place. It is a hiding place. A place where we can be concealed and covered. Where we can be secure. The psalmist identifies this secret place as under God's wings. This image not only speaks of protection and shelter, but also of closeness and intimacy. Before we can rest in the security of God, we must continually draw near to him. We must live in close communion with the Lord. Are you with me?
Yes.
The second thing is because of who he is. Someone say, because of who he is.
Because of who he is.
There's a songwriter that says, because of who you are, I give you glory.
Yes.
Because of who you are, I give you praise.
Yes.
One of the ways God has revealed himself to us is through his names. A prominent feature of Hebrew poetry is the restating of a thought using synonyms. Different words that mean the same thing. However, this is not the case here. The psalmist's repeated reference to God using different names is for a distinct purpose. Each name reveals who God is to his people. This year, we're determined to be strong. We're determined, first and foremost, to know God so that we may be strong and do great exploits.
Yeah.
One of the names is the Most High, and the Hebrew name is Elyon.
Yes.
He is the highest, the supreme being, and the owner of the universe. As such, he is all-powerful and cannot be overthrown. We serve a God that cannot be overthrown. No matter what state the world is in, politically or any other way, know that God is still in control. He's on the throne. And we have hope in him. He is all-powerful and cannot be overthrown. This name cuts every threat down to size. He's El Elyon. He is the Almighty. He is the Shaddai God. He is sufficient for everything we need. By his inherent power, he sustains us, he protects us, and he provides for us.
Yes.
But if you don't know that, and you don't declare that, you won't have anything, just as Jesus said, that we have what we say.
Yeah.
Ask and it shall be.
Yes.
Seek and ye shall.
Fine.
Knock and the door shall be.
Open.
He is the Lord, Yahweh, Jehovah. He is the faithful God who makes a covenant with us and keeps his covenant without fail. God keeps his covenant with his people.
Yes.
It's his people that break covenant with him. When people become unfaithful, he just has to hold true to his word. Are you with me?
Yes.
He keeps all of his promises always. Look at someone and say, always.
Always.
The psalmist says, my God. The word, the Hebrew word Elohim emphasizes, and that's the word here. Elohim emphasizes the fullness and exceeding greatness of God's power. This possessive pronoun, my, declares that we can have a personal, intimate relationship with him.
Amen. Amen.
We don't have to go through a mediator. We can go directly to Him. He knows us, communes with us, and cares for us individually and personally. He knows every hair that's on our head. Even as someone told me, even the hair you sew in. I said, whoa. Even when you shave all your hair off, I'm letting the ladies know I'm not just hanging out with y'all, but even when you shave all your hair off, He knows where all those little hair follicles are. You can't hide that shadow from Him. Because He is your security in all things, He is, verse 2 says, He is my refuge. Notice, refuge. My refuge. My fortress. My God. Notice here, it's actually a dividing line here. Everyone in the world can't say this. A lot of people refer to Psalm 91, but everybody can't say that He is their God, that He is their fortress, that He is their refuge. It's only with those that have relationship with the Father. Are y'all with me? Let's see if I can shorten this, because if I can't shorten it to the time frame that I'm supposed to, there will have to be a B or a C.
That's all right.
Because the psalmist understood who God is to His people, he was able to say with confidence that the Lord was his personal security, his refuge and fortress. A refuge is a shelter from trouble or danger. A fortress is a safe, secure place that is inaccessible to the enemy. Therefore, the psalmist declared that he would continually trust in the Lord. He would fully depend on Him for protection and security, and he would faithfully run to Him when threatened by danger or trouble. All that God is, His character and divine attributes, is even more available to us today in the church age than it was to God's people when the psalm was written. Why? Because He dwells in us.
Yes.
His power does not merely work for us, but also works in us and through us by His indwelling Spirit.
Yes.
In light of that, we need to draw near to God and to live in the fullness of His presence in every aspect in our lives. Simply stated, we need to abide in Christ. We have open access into God's presence, a great privilege secured for us by the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
But before we can abide in His presence, we have to be clean. We need to allow God's word to purify our hearts and our lives so we can live in His holy presence at all times. John wrote, "Abide in me." And these are the words that Jesus said, "Abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide where? In the vine. No more can ye except ye abide in me." Jesus says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me," he said, "you can do nothing." The next thing I need to share with you from verse 3 through 8, really, is that we need to believe God. Trust Him to help you. God protects those who draw near to Him. In every dangerous situation of life, we need to believe God and trust Him to help us rather than living in a state of fear. He will save you from the foe's trap and from the fatal plague. How many have ever heard the voice of the Lord and He warns you of something?
Yes.
Or when danger is near? Or if you're faced with a situation that seems to get a grip, God will just let you know you need to trust in me.
Yes.
Sometimes He'll tell you, "I got you." Sometimes He'll tell you, you know how you like to use this, "I got this."
Yeah.
He said it first.
Yeah.
He said it first. "I got this." God will deliver us if we trust in him. The snare of the fowler and the noisome pestilence and the deadly pestilence represent all the dangers we face in life. A fowler was a hunter of birds and symbolizes those who seek to harm or destroy us. A pestilence was a dreaded deadly disease or epidemic. And God knows how to take care of his people.
Yes, yes, yes.
For he made us.
Yeah.
As the word of God says, we are the sheep of his pasture. Amen?
Amen.
It's his pasture. And sometimes you just need to tell him, Lord, I'm a sheep. I'm in your pasture. And you said you're going to take care of me. Amen?
Amen.
It's okay to talk to God. It's okay to call. He said, call on me and I will answer you.
Yes.
He will cover and protect us under his wings and he will care for us. God is omnipotent.
Yes.
All powerful. He will cover and protect us under his wings of care. In fact, that's what this Psalm 91 represents. The covering of God. The psalmist compared God's care for his people to a bird gathering her young under her wings in order to protect them. This is a common picture throughout the Old Testament. It is also the image used by Jesus to describe his great love for the Jews and his desire to save them. The Lord will be our refuge. He will be our covering and protect us in the dangers of life. I'm going to move as fast as I can. I just need to share just a few more things. The truth or faithfulness of God will be our shield and buckler.
Yes.
I'll say that again. The truth. The truth.
Yes.
And faithfulness of God will be our shield and buckler. His word will be our shield, our buckler.
Yes.
The truth. The truth is Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He will be our shield and buckler. You said, well, why have I suffered pain or why have I suffered this? Let me tell you this and remind you of this. Had he not gone before us and taken the sting of death, for instance, and taken the stripes of sickness and disease, it would be so harsh until we couldn't stand it.
Amen.
Are y'all with me?
Yes. Yeah.
For the Bible says, he was wounded for our, and he was bruised for our, and the chastisement of our
peace.
Thank you, Father. Think about it. You say, I need peace. Let me tell you something. There are things that will happen to try to take your peace. But know this one thing. He went ahead and he dealt with things that would rob us of peace of mind. But had he not done that, we would all be somewhere locked up. It's a real thing. It's real. The shield was a large rectangular piece of armor that a soldier would hide behind and be completely covered. The Hebrew word for buckler appears only here in the Old Testament. It refers to the smaller handheld shield used in close combat. And in the New Testament, God has given his faithful promises to us to use as our armor for life's battle. You said where? Prove it. Turn to Ephesians. The 6th chapter. And verse 11. His word. He says, put on the just part of the armor. Just on Sunday. Put on the whole armor. Not part of the armor, but the whole armor of God that you may be able to do what? Against the for we wrestle not but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness, where? Wherefore take unto you, again he emphasizes, the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, he said what?
Stand.
Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with what? With truth, with the Lord, with the word of God, and having on the breastplate of
righteousness,
and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of
peace.
above all taking the
shield of faith,
wherewith ye shall be able to quench some of the fiery darts. Half of the fiery darts. Three quarters of it. All of the fiery darts of the and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is praying. Now, listen. If you don't have these things on, the enemy can just totally wipe you out. Just briefly. You get up tomorrow morning to go to your various jobs or school, and you didn't do any of this. And all of a sudden, you get hit. The first thing you do, you get hit here. And then you try to figure out, now how am I going to deal with this? Without going the blankety blank blank blank. Because you got to refresh yourself and remind yourself who you are and what you're supposed to have on. And that time with the Lord and having the helmet on, it protects you, and the Lord will just tell you just what to do. Mm-hmm. In fact, he will tell you before you get there.
That's true.
I mean, if you have that fellowship and that communion and that meditation, that inner life you're dealing with, this is what it's all about.
Yes, it's about. Amen.
Knowing who we are and knowing who he is. Because, listen, if I don't go back to my notes, y'all can just deal with it, right?
Yeah.
You said, well, I was born to my mother, my father, they raised me, I'm going to school, and I did this, and I got this career, and I got that, and this is what life is all about. Not so.
Amen.
We are here for his purpose.
Yes.
Jeremiah 29:11 says, for what? I know the plans that I have for you. The plans that I have for you are what?
Good and not evil.
And not evil. To give you a hope and a future. We are not here to carry out our life's mission. We're really not. We really have no choice but to obey him if you want to live a victorious life. If you want to live a full life, if you want to receive a reward at the end, are y'all with me?
Yes.
It's not my will. Jesus said, it's not my will, Lord, but thy will be done. It's all about him. That's what life is. He said, that's what life is all about. It's all about, pleasing the Father, because actually he sent you. He sent me. Surely there was a natural coming together. I'm not going to go into the nitty-gritty, parents. Don't have to worry about it. But there was a natural coming together, but it was for his glory.
Amen.
And at the same time that happened, the Spirit of the Lord sent his anointing. He said, everything happened. And succinctly, God did it for his glory.
Amen.
He said, okay, I got a purpose and plan for you.
Yeah.
And it's not a plan that I'm going to present to you when you get... And let me pause here. That's why it's important for us as adults to impart to our children the purpose and plans of God.
Yes.
He said, bring them up in the way that they
should.
And when they get old,
it will not.
The truth will not depart from them. And we need to do that. We need to go back to that. Are y'all with me?
Yes.
Speak into your children's lives. Speak into the baby's life. Speak into the baby's life that's being carried in the womb. I believe that strongly.
Amen.
Yes.
Because if you don't know who you are, the world will let you know who they want you to be.
That's right.
And they will pull out the worst in you.
Yes.
And can I go here? I can go here and meddle. Because if you don't know who you are in your family will bring out the worst
in
you.
They will.
Amen.
Yes, they will.
You know that song? You bring out the best in me. Well, they don't bring out the best in you. They don't bring out the worst. I know you. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. I love my family, but they will, there is one.
Always.
There is one. And that one is notorious. And I purpose for that individual not to be victorious. You got to know who you are.
Amen.
And he wants us to know who he is. Amen?
Amen.
Let me move real quick, and then definitely will have to be another part to this, because I don't think that you would be patient enough to sit here that long. God will reassure you through all fearful situations. God's powerful and protective presence reassures us in the fearful situations of life. And although the world is swarming with violent, wicked people, we need not fear terror or attacks. Likewise, perils abound in our sin-cursed world, but we have no reason to be frightened or panic in times of disease or destruction due to life-threatening disasters. Why? Because God will either protect or deliver us through times of inescapable danger, even when thousands of others are doomed. The mention of night, day, darkness, and noonday reinforces the great truth that God never sleeps. He never slumbers. He protects us at all times around the clock. We can work and sleep in peace, for God is on guard. He will make sure you escape and witness the punishment of the wicked. I had a time where I went through some persecution on a job, and I worked for a particular not-for-profit organization, Catholic organization. That's as far as I'm going. I'm not going to tell you anymore about where. But I gave it my all. I did the best job that I could do. And I interceded on the job. My assignment was to collect finances for insurance claims. And I took an assignment very briefly. I got to wrap this up. I took an assignment to work for a clinic here in Middletown. And they got maybe $5 a week. And we had a client list. It was a big client list. And so my boss had said, I don't know, Verdell, if you're going to get anything for these old claims. So he took me in the office, and he showed me this file cabinet, and I opened it up, and those claims were 5, 6, 7 years old, and the person before me and the person before that person, they had just given up and stopped, you know, calling. So I would pray. Now, I would not take my Bible and open it up on my desk. Okay? I did not get on my knees. I did not pray in the Holy Ghost openly. I did not speak in tongues and stuff like that. But on the inside, I was practicing the presence. And I said, okay, God, you're going to have to show me. I got to earn my keep here. Because before I went there, my supervisor, who happened to be jealous of me, for whatever reason, I don't know, because I was always trying to do what I needed to do. And she said, that's a dead-end job. You're not going to get anything. Well, what happened is it was a promotion for me, and I was on the same level as her. And she was shooting me down before I could get there. And I said, Lord, I really got to do this job, because I like, you know, helping people, and I like them to get some money. Well, The first check came in, and my boss said, how'd you do this? I said, well, Mike, I pray. And he said, okay. And we had another you know, meeting, and they said, normally I wouldn't go into the meeting. It would just be for the clinicians. Come on in. And I said, okay. Tell us what you got this time. And I said, what are you talking about? You got some checks. I said, yeah, $1,000. We've never gotten $1,000. And to make a long story short, months went by, and all of a sudden they got double digits. They got $10,000. Then they got 20-some thousand. Then I think it was about $30,000. And I happened to go on vacation, okay? And when I got back, they said, all of the clinics were, you know, later. All the supervisors. Well, did you go on vacation with that money? I said, that money? What are you talking about? Because they were hearing wind that all of a sudden, this poor clinic all of a sudden started raking in the money. And all I would do was just sit, and I was being abused by being put on hold. They put you on hold, the insurance companies, and I'd listen to the music. Then I'd go to the file cabinet and I'd file. And then I'd pick up the flow notes and I'd type the flow notes. I could go even into the conference room and make a fresh pot of coffee. All of those things. Oh, are you there? Yes. Claim so-and-so and so. I said, yes, you haven't paid it, and it's so-and-so, and this is all the information. Oh, we'll think about it. But my boss had already told me, you will not get any money. All those old claims. What was God doing? He was honoring the prayer. I said, Lord, you see that all that these people are due money. And they paid it. And they said, oh, you'll never get any more money. I said, okay. But God dealt with the heart of those people that were just holding the money. All they had to do was start sending the checks, and they were coming. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I'm telling you, God will work through you. He'll work on your behalf, and he'll begin to turn things around. And then one day when I was going in the office, God was dealing with me. He said, close for non-compliance. I said, no! No, Lord, don't close the clinic. And the Lord gave us grace and kept the clinic open. And then all of a sudden, I started seeing the demise of what was happening is the clinicians were not doing their flow notes, and they weren't, so it wasn't on me because the money was coming in, but they needed to comply with the state in order for the place to stay open. But he kept it open until I got into another place, because I said, okay, God, don't shut this place down. Let me get another job. But God will take care of his people. He will hear you when you pray. So again, as I said before, as I went into this, you are here for a purpose, but whatever your hands are assigned to do, know this one thing, that God will be in it with you, but there's condition. There must be relationship with the Father. You can't have all the goods and you're not living to his expectations.
All
right. Let me move real quickly. The Bible says that he wants us to be aware. In Psalm, let me go to Psalm 91 and 9. Go very quickly to that. Back to that. Got to wrap this up. It says, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. God's protection, again, is conditional. It is, look at someone and say, it is conditional. The psalmist emphasized that God's protection is afforded only to those who live in his presence and take refuge in him. In other words, it is conditional. The faithful are guarded by God's angels. I'll say it again. The faithful are guarded by God's angels. They will protect them from physical and spiritual danger. The faithful. Then his presence will be with you when facing evil threats. The psalmist continued to emphasize God's protective care over those who abide in his shelter under the shadow of the Almighty. His presence is with them when they face evil threats or plagues. They are secure. The faithful are secure in the Lord, their minds and homes, under his constant watch. God will take care of you, but you've got to trust and believe and obey him.
Amen.
From time to time, we may narrowly miss incidents where physical injury or death was a certainty. Somehow, though, we escaped. At other times, our plans do not work out, or we are delayed, or we are strangely led to travel a different route. How many know?
I know that's
different route than we planned. Mm-hmm. We should always remember that these occurrences may be the result of angels working on God's behalf to protect and preserve our life. Sometimes God will tell you you're taking another route.
Yeah.
Sometimes God will tell you you need to do this. Sometimes you'll be wondering, why am I delayed?
Yeah.
And God will let us know it's because of my protection. You may not know until after.
Right.
Sometimes I've been riding on 84 and the Lord will just direct me to another route. And sometimes on 84 I'm still on it and I see an accident ahead of me and I said, wow, maybe that's why I got delayed in Chester. Sometimes it's because of sometimes your delay is because of an angel protecting you.
Yes.
Yes. Give God some praise for that.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. will protect us. For as he says, for he shall give his angels charge over you. I claim those promises.
Amen.
Maybe they were written, and we know they were written first to the children of Israel, but I claim these promises.
Yes.
I remember the last trip we went on to the Philippines. Before we left the United States, I said, Lord, I'm concerned about going on this trip. I'm concerned about your servant. I'm concerned about us going on this trip. And Apostle, you know, he would get a new lease on life when he started thinking about Philippines. I mean, it was just like, whoa. And I remember the Lord speaking, there shall no evil befall you. Neither shall any plague come nigh your dwelling. Those are the only two things that I heard him say. There shall no evil befall you. Neither shall any plague come nigh your dwelling. I said, oh God, I thank you. All on the plane, he said, there shall no evil befall you, neither shall any plague come nigh your dwelling. He was letting me know comfort. He was letting me know comforting words. There shall no evil befall you. When I climbed up to the top of Chocolate Hills, he said, there shall no evil befall you, neither shall any plague come nigh your dwelling. When it got real hot, I mean really hot, it was hot there. He said, there shall no evil befall you, neither shall any plague come nigh your dwelling. God was true to his word, brought us back safely. God will take care of you.
Yes.
You just have to abide in him. Amen?
Amen.
I'm going to bring this to a close. We're going to have to do a part B and a part C.